So, good evening, guys. Good afternoon. Sorry, in Brazil, we are at 3 p.m. And today we are on the part in the afternoon of Teacher Training Summit 2022. And now we are with Workshop 6, which is named Digital Literacy Roles and Challenges. We are on session one with Professor Flavio Martins. Flavio Martins has a master's in education and teaching, technological education and society, or IUFMG, digital technologies specialist for FAVENI, English teacher improvement course for University of Oregon in the USA. He's also a specialist in computer-mediated language teaching for Bali, UFMG. He's also outstanding in education technologies in Secretariat of Education of Montagem, MG, Minas Gerais. He is teacher trainer in education technologies, canal Máquina de Ideias on YouTube and Secretaria de Educação de Contagem, Minas Gerais. He's also pedagogical coordinator from CACS Languages, UFMG. He is teacher trainer in T4T PhD project. He is also technology educator, Máquina de Ideias channel on YouTube, and teaching material developer. He is also English language teacher from regular courses and instrumental English. Okay, so this is only one person. He's Flavio Martins, and now Flavio, welcome to the workshop. I hope you have a good presentation, and now the word is yours, okay?
Okay, thank you very much. It's very nice to be here with you this afternoon. And I know that there may be people from other places in the world. So good morning, good night, good evening, and good afternoon to everybody. I'm Flavio. I've been working with English and technology for a long time. I should say I'm very sorry for the external noise. There is a dog in the neighborhood. I'm not sure if you're listening to it. And I'm very cold these days, so it's kind of difficult for me to be talking for a long time. So I have my water bottle here, and I hope we can have good time together. This workshop is based on my experience throughout the month since the beginning of COVID-19 pandemic, and I've been reading, discussing, and reflecting upon the way technology has been seen by teachers, professors, students, families, and government. As I work for the public school secretary here in my state, I've been dealing on a daily basis with the idea of having technology to help solve problems caused by the pandemic. And the things that we are going to be seeing here are very much based on my experience on a daily basis. So I truly think that technology can be an asset, can be something very important for us in the schools. But at the same time, I'm very much sure that we should be discussing and reflecting on the role technology has in education nowadays, mainly after this pandemic or during this pandemic, because it hasn't finished yet. And at the same time, I think we should be discussing on the roles and challenges we have regarding technology in education, because mostly people have this idea that teachers are the know-it-all kind of person, or the kind of person that can solve any problems related to learning. And sometimes families and other important agents are taken out of this situation. And we know for sure that there's no such a thing. Teachers, we are only one very important part of the process of education. and for people to be learning and for teachers to be teaching. There are many other roles. They're very important in this situation. So my idea here is to bring you a couple of questions, or a couple of thoughts, so that you may be reflecting upon the way technology has been changing our way of teaching and what we have been doing in our schools in a way that we may be able to have more people helping us on this very difficult task there is to teach right after or even during the pandemic that we're living. If you have any questions, please just let me know. You can interrupt me at any time. There's no problem on that. I'll be sharing my screen with you. Presentation.
Just excuse me, Professor Flavio. Guys, the attendance list will be shared with you through a link, okay, from 40 to 50 minutes from the start, okay? And if you want to ask a question and you don't want to speak, you would use the question and answer section on the right corner of the screen, okay? Or if you wanted to make a question by ask a question by speaking, as Flavio said, you can do it at any time, okay? Thank you.
All right, can you see the presentation?
Yes, it's on the right slide, Teacher Education Summit.
Yeah, that's it. So basically, this is the way I used to introduce myself. I'm a public school teacher, and I help teachers learn a bit about the ways we can use technology in education, because it's something that has been my area of study since the beginning of the 2000s. So I share knowledge about technology. I discuss, I learn about technology in education, and I love it very much. Well, to start with, the name of the presentation is Digital Literacy Roles and Challenges. We know that we have been facing too many challenges, but we also should be reflecting on the roles each person or each agent has during this situation we are all living across the world. The thing is, there is this guy, Alvin Toffler. He used to be a scientist. And he has this sentence that I love very much. The literate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. As teachers, I think that it's very important for us to be learning, unlearning, and relearning all the time, because things change all the time. The students we used to have 5 years ago are very much different from the students we have nowadays. And as long as technology gets into education, and as long as these two things are almost impossible to separate, technology from education, it's getting harder and harder for us to cope with all this challenge, because sometimes the students know a lot about technology, but not necessarily they know how to learn using technology. And people may have questions about the way students can be learning more and the way teachers can be using more technology in order to make students learn more. But basically, we can reflect that education after the COVID-19 pandemic and during the COVID-19 pandemic has been facing too many challenges. We can reflect on the experience of learning. We can reflect on the experience of teaching. And there are many different and complex questions. For example, what will schools look like after the pandemic? We don't know, because things are still changing. The technologies are coming up every day, and every day we can see different situations. There were many companies offering services to schools and school systems so that they would be saying that these things could be kind of helping teachers and administrators to solve problems related to connection and to sharing content. But we know that education goes far beyond that. And there are two situations, two prevalent narratives, they're rising over the horizon. The situation number one is that the pandemic brought schools to adopt many things because, as you all know, there was no person in this planet that was prepared to face the problems related to the pandemic. And in the education, it wasn't any different. So the two prevalent narratives after pandemic or after this moment that the schools were reopened are, number one, schools seek to return to normal and to resume the familiar rhythms of teaching and learning, much as they were long before the COVID disruption. So as if the situations they had with technology and Google Meet and Zoom and Google Classroom and Microsoft Teams, many schools administrators just thought that there would be enough for them to get students coming back to schools and just continuing the process of education. But many people know that that's not what really happened because students came with problems and anxiety, and people were suffering from situations related to sociability. And the second narrative that are, in my opinion, there is very much necessary is when schools intensify their programs to remediate learning loss. And so students come up with longer hours of studying, tutoring, and developing and adopting learning tools which are digitally mediated. Well, there is a problem here. As long as the students are getting used to more technology, teachers also have to get used to use new technology. And sometimes teachers and students have very different approaches to technology. And we have a problem here. When schools intensify their programs, they want to recover, they want to get back to schools with the students in classroom, like face-to-face education. And some teachers continue to use technology, and many other teachers just have left technology out of their practices. In the first moment, they were using technology to mediate learning all along the year with their students. And right after, when they come back to schools, most of them are abandoning technology. So we have to think a little bit about this. The other point is that when teachers take technology into the school or into the school system, when administrators, they buy or they adopt digitally mediated techniques or digitally mediated learning tools, the problem is that teachers and students, they have very different levels of digital literacy. But then there is this guy, Mark Prensky, and that, in my opinion, he wrote a book, he wrote an article discussing the way digital literacy is present in society. And he brought two concepts for us. And in my opinion, it's a trap. We are all trapped in these two concepts. There are digital immigrants and digital natives. Why is it a trap? It's a trap because the characteristics of the immigrants and the characteristics of natives that he brings are very much based on age or on the years those people were born. And we all know that many people are not very much into technology, even regarding the year they were born in. Just to get back to what Prensky said back in 2001, like 21 years ago, he wrote this article saying that digital immigrants are people like you and me, people who are over 25, 30 years old, or people who are at the moment teaching in our schools. So we would be the digital immigrants. And it's very important to understand the role of an immigrant in a society. An immigrant is a person who comes from another land, a person who doesn't have or who can't have all the rights people from that place has, a person who has difficulty in communication, a person who has difficulty in adaptation. And when I say that, for example, teachers from this time are digital immigrants, I must analyze the situation in which I can recognize that this is somewhat a kind of a prejudice against immigrants, because in my opinion, in this sense, digital immigrants are not seen as a good thing. On the other side, he brings digital natives, that would be those people that were born during or after the digital age. So I have a daughter, she's 9 years old, and she would be a digital native according to Mark Prensky's article. And I'm a teacher. I teach public school students from the sixth and seventh grade, and I know for sure that digital natives do not exist. Digital natives, digital immigrants, these concepts are traps for us. On the same time, we have to see, to analyze that according to Mark Prensky's thought, this idea of digital immigrants and digital natives is very much related to personal influence, because he believes that through experience with technology, digital immigrants, for example, can gain digital citizenship. And we know that it doesn't happen that way. My mother, she's 57, and she's been trying to deal with technology, and it's very, very difficult for her. She's 57. But at the same time, I have a nephew who's 10 years old and hates technology and doesn't relate very much well with technology. So Mark Prensky's and other writers have said that the contact with technology would make people migrate, or would make people move from a very basic literacy, digital literacy level, to a higher digital literacy level. It may happen, but it doesn't necessarily happen on the way they have predicted. Well, I question Mark Prensky's concepts, basically, because when you have something that is based on age or is age-related hypothesis, I am leaving out many other aspects of the same situation. And then when I was researching on this topic for my master's, I came to find an article of a person saying that digital immigrants and digital natives are concepts that are kind of old and do not necessarily represent what people are doing and what people are living and what technology has been doing in our society nowadays. And most of the authors that I have read talking about this, they've been discussing things connected somewhat to visitors or residents. That means digital visitors or digital residents, as like a metaphor of place and tool, considering behavior, motivation, and context. That means it doesn't matter if you were born 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. What's going to make the connection or with technology, or what's going to help define the level of digital literacy of you is the context you're living in, the motivation you have to deal or not with technology, the place where you were at, the tools you are using are not in the behavior you have regarding technology. So there are many other aspects related to digital literacy than only the age-related hypothesis that was brought by Mark Prensky. I like this concept, visitors and residents, digital visitors and digital residents, much more than the idea of natives and immigrants, as I think that native and immigrants are very much connected to the idea of people who belong and people who do not belong. Visitors and residents, you may have different levels of contact and very different levels of digital literacy. And the article that I like the most about this was written by David White from Oxford University and Alison, Cornu. She's a high education professor in the UK. I can share with you all these references in the end. But then it doesn't matter if you adopt the first, concepts, Mark Prensky's concept, or White and Cornu concepts, we come to a challenge. What is this challenge? Sometimes teachers have very low level of digital literacy. And sometimes the students are much higher interested and much more connected to the technology world, and they demand that kind of knowledge and that kind of commitment from the teacher. And I have been working with teacher education regarding technology, people from all over the country, and it's not rare for me to get emails and messages from teachers who are desperate because they do not know how to act or they do not know how to work using technological tools. It's a problem. But in many situations, what I think is very, very important for us to discuss is that sometimes teachers, professors, students, and families, and society in general, are confusing the differences, the concepts of computer skills and digital literacy skills, which are things very different one from the other. Computer skills and digital literacy skills, because computer skills are very much connected to know how to use the computer, how to turn it on, how to turn it off, how to get into a website, how to print a piece of paper, or how to be dealing with search on the internet. This is very much connected to computer skills. And many students, many teenagers, many young people are very much comfortable with the idea of using computer on a daily basis. But the thing is, research evidence indicates that a proportion of young people are highly adept with technology, and they rely on this aspect of life for a range of information gathering and communication activities. So, for example, they use the social media apps, they use the games apps, but there are many situations and there are many things that they do not have a clue about how to be dealing with technology in the context, for example, in education. There also appears to be a significant proportion of young people who do not have the levels of access or the levels of skill technology skills predicted by proponents of the digital native area or the digital native idea. Because supposing that a person is a digital native, this person wouldn't have any problems by using technology in the different areas of this person's life. And we know that it doesn't happen that way. So it's a problem because such generalizations about a whole generation of young people that focus attention on being natives or not being native concerning technology, this is very, very bad for them because there are levels of people, there are levels of knowledge, there are levels of knowledge or levels of contact with technology that can define if this person is really very skillful or not. And that comes the danger that the less interested or the less able people regarding technology, they might be neglected. And the potential impact of social, economic, and cultural factors will be overlooked, because we know that when I say that a person is a native, let's suppose talking about languages, a person is a native from Brazil, a person from Brazil, supposedly this person knows Portuguese very well. But when we talk about this regarding technology, it doesn't happen this way, because technology costs money, and it's not everybody that have access to technology on the same way. So it may be that there is much variation with the digital native generation, as there are many variations between the generations themselves. And we also know that many young students are very far from being the fluent digital native person or kind of person. And many of them also are not very patient about learning through technology. Many of them have difficulty on doing this. So the thing is, there is some evidence that younger students use some tools more actively than others or than the older students. But neither of these groups uses these technologies to support their learning effectively. And then comes the role of a teacher. So if we have students, young students, who are very, very much in trouble because they do not know how to act, or they do not know how to use the technology the schools have been providing them with, it's the role of a teacher to be working on this. But as I said before, many teachers also lack digital literacy, and it's a very, very serious problem. So educations cannot presume that all young students are digital natives who understand how to use technology, or who understand how to use technology to support and enhance their learning. It must be mediated by teachers who are very comfortable with their digital literacy level. And I would be saying that the digital natives or the digital immigrants distinction is dead, or at least it's dying, because all of these facts that I've been bringing to you. Well, coming back to talk about computer skills and digital literacy skills, I told you that computer skills are very much connected to the use of the machine, to the use of the tools on a very technician way or technician way. But digital literacy skills is very much connected to the 21st century skills, because by using the computer or the technology in a way that it can really help students learn, or even the teachers, we should be considering the functional skills. We should be considering the use of this technology to help studying or learning through technology, using our creativity, and it should be supporting and demanding students to think critically and to evaluate things. There is also this cultural and social understanding of the role of students in society, of the role of education in society. We should be aware of the situation in which students can collaborate by doing things together. And so we should be able to understand the way the technological tools work, so that we can provide students with proper commands, so that they can be making good use of this in order to co-create content. Also concerning this connection between digital literacy skills and the 21st century skills, it's important to consider the ability to find and select information. We've been dealing a lot with fake news, and we've been dealing a lot with knowledge that are not reliable And many people do not understand the difference between what's true and what's a lie. So it's the role of a teacher to be working on this perspective, because it promotes critical thinking. It promotes real education in a way that this person can be a good citizen who knows about his or her rights and who know how to deal with problems that come on a daily basis to their lives. And it also is important to be analyzing the probability of working, the possibility of working with this, because of the safety, e-safety. There are lots of crimes that have been committed by people using the digital tools, the technological tools. And many times our students, our young students are victims of criminals on the internet because they do not know how to identify what's going on. They do not know how to understand the situations. And also when a person is digitally literate, this person can, besides all these points that I've brought, this person can be a very good communicator and can put out all the things he or she thinks and can be using technology to spread the word, to be sharing information, to be contributing to a society. There is more connected to good values and things like that. But just to let you think a little bit about this, it should be interesting to analyze, for example, the hypothesis of digital literacy skills in a perspective of teaching. For example, connecting the 21st century skills with literacy skills, digital literacy skills. We can analyze, for example, this example. We can analyze this example, critical thinking. For example, despite being red, Mars is a cold place full of iron oxide dust. Regarding creativity, Mercury is the closest planet to the sun and the smallest one. Reliable communicator, Venus has a beautiful name, but it also high temperatures. Curate information, Neptune is the farthest planet from the sun. E-safety, despite being red, Mars is a cold place full of iron oxide dust. It's comparing to the critical thinking aspect. And so we have all these things, like you have the information, you connect this information with the 21st century skills, and you can use technology connected to this so that you can have deeper thoughts about the content you're providing your students with.